Hi, my name's Tarek. I'm a senior lecturer in biochemical engineering and I specialise in vaccine research. And this is Mike.
Hi, my name's Mike and I'm the manager of the fermentation half of the pilot plant.
Wait, what's a pilot plant?
Ah, a very good question, Tarek. So a pilot plant is kind of an intermediate size of industrial facility in between lab scale and full industrial scale.
So there are actually no pilots in a pilot plant?
There are no pilots, and more importantly, no plant. So it's basically for piloting bioprocesses.
Ah, so that's why it's called a pilot plant.
Yes.
I get it. So essentially, once you've done all your research and development on the bench scale, just before leaping into commercial scale, this is where you test out those ideas.
Exactly.
Good. Interesting. And I suppose that lots of academic departments have a pilot plant.
Oh, if only they did, Tarek, if only they did. But we are like a unicorn amongst universities.
A beautiful unicorn.
Yes. But we are the only one.
In the UK?
In the UK.
In Europe?
In Europe. Not in the world, though.
Not in the world.
No, but okay. In Europe.
Nice.
So I would describe this as the workhorse of all bioprocesses. This is a bioreactor. It's a piece of wonder, a thing of beauty, and we have many of them of varying sizes.
I mean, we can tell you more about the bioreactor, but really that's kind of like the first quarter of the course, so why don't you just come here instead and we'll teach you all about it. But anyway, where are we now, Mike?
We are currently in the fermentation room. I guess here we'll be talking about scaling up and scaling down bioprocesses, looking at the range of things that we can grow. So we grow different types of yeasts and other microbes, algae, and in a completely separate room, we'll grow some mammalian cells too.
Okay, so let's take an example. Let's imagine that I've created a new vaccine.
It's a protein. Good.
And I've re-engineered yeast to make that vaccine.
Okay.
What are my next steps?
So, if you have this process currently in a shake flask, you might want to think about trying to do some preliminary optimization in a bioreactor.
All right.
I would start small.
How small?
As small as you can. In this department, our smallest bioreactors are 250 millilitres.
What, like these reactors over here?
Yes. They are perfect.
So we have little jam jar. Oh! What, like?
Like these.
Yeah. Flawlessly cut into the shot. Excellent. So these miniature little bioreactors can mimic, say, a 100 litre bioreactor, like that big cylinder thing over there.
That's exactly what they're for. The beauty of these are they're single use, so you get to throw them away after you use them. That saves on cleaning. Also, that they are almost exactly a scaled-down mimic of a larger reactor, and you can run more than one at once.
That's interesting. So I imagine there's a lot of engineering that goes into the design of these things and also understanding the hydrodynamics, the fluid dynamics, and the scaling between a small jam jar vessel to a large stainless steel vessel.
There is, and that's exactly what you'll learn if you come here.
When do we get to use these reactors as MSC students?
So, in terms of actually using these pieces of equipment, from the little jam jar reactors over here to the large stainless steel equipment over there, the learning that you have as part of your lectures are supplemented by real hands-on experience in the lab itself. So, through a variety of laboratory workshops and training, you'll have exposure to all these types of equipment. But in addition, we also have a one-week pilot plant week scenario. And so that's really to give you the expertise of understanding whole bioprocessing, so understanding how from engineering a cell to scaling up into a reactor such as this, all the way through to downstream purification, will be the main mandate of that one-week training scenario.
And just to get an idea of exactly how tall that reactor is, what's your height?
I'm about 1 meter 90.
There you go.
Yes, I'm 1 meter 75. Just come over from fermentation.
Indeed.
What area is this?
Ah, so this is the downstream part of the process.
Otherwise known as downstream process?
Yes.
Interesting. So let's imagine I've engineered my cell, it's making my vaccine. I've now got lots and lots of biomass from those bioreactors in the other room, right?
Yep.
Now I've brought them here. What's next?
So from the description you've just given me, what you're telling me is the magic has already happened.
And in the cell.
Part, indeed.
Yes.
And this part is all about getting that magic out. So either the cells are your product or the cells will make your product. And if they make your product, they're either going to be inside the cell or outside the cell.
Let's assume the magic, or let's just call it the vaccine, is inside the cell.
Ah, if we make that assumption, then we have to break the cell open.
Okay. With what, hammer? What are we doing?
No, a hammer would be too big and a bit too brutish. I think what we would use in this case is a homogenizer.
Interesting.
A homogenizer simply uses a pressure differential to cause a cell wall to rupture.
Ah, right. So almost through cavitation.
Indeed.
The cells will then have to burst open as it moves from a high pressure to a low pressure environment.
Yes, exactly that.
I see that. All right. So now I've got my homogenate, my broken bits of cell, also interspaced with some of my vaccine, and of course all that other contaminating host cell protein and nucleic acid. What do we do next?
You say vaccine, I say magic.
Okay.
So to get the magic out, we need to do first of all a solid liquid separation technique. I would use a centrifuge, just like this one here.
Oh my god.
It's a thing of beauty.
What does this fit to?
That's a motor.
What does the red button do?
That stops it.
Can we press the red button?
Don't press the red button.
All right, fine. So we use a centrifuge, very much like the salad spinner of biotechnology.
Indeed.
Separate the solid cell debris from the liquid components.
Yep.
We've got the liquid components. My nucleic acid, my host cell protein, and the vaccine is still in that liquid component. How do I separate the vaccine from all the other impurities and purities?
Very, very good question. Now, to get the magic out, what you need to do is something I like to call chromatography. And I call it that because that's what it's called.
Lucky.
Yes.
So maybe chromatography is a way of separating different species based on size and charge using a solvent flux.
It is indeed. Also, you can use not just size and charge, but also hydrophobicity. And you can have a specific ligand, so affinity chromatography also.
Cool. All right. So I then go through chromatography. I separated my product from my impurities.
Yes.
Job done.
Indeed, all you have left is the magic.
You mean fill finishing?
Yes.
Good. So, what is this?
This is a Tecan Evo liquid handling robot.
And what do you do with these types of liquid handling systems?
So these systems are really there to bring together the three strands of research we have within the department. One being using single-use systems, mm-hmm. as these little 96 well plates are single-use.
Yeah.
The other being scaling down bioprocesses, because these are obviously much smaller than all the process units we've seen so far.
Sure.
And also automating systems. So we use a liquid handling robot to remove any kind of human error out of the process.
I see. So once I've engineered my cells, rather than going through a 30-liter bioreactor and then all the way through downstream processing to try and get to my final product, yep. I can try and mimic that entire pilot scale process using these small liquid handling plates?
Exactly that.
I don't believe you.
Good, because it's not true. But most of the process you can mimic using these. You can definitely do cell line screening, fermentations.
Yep.
You can do filtration, but not in a 96 well plate.
Yep.
You can do chromatography.
Yep.
Again, a slightly larger scale, but also with liquid handling.
So rather than go through the rigmarole and I guess the time and effort of one process at a time, we can screen multiple factors using these plates and try and have a much more high throughput methodology of creating vaccines in my case.
Indeed.
Sounds fantastic. So is it just research scientists who get to play with this, or do students also get to play with this stuff?
I think it's very dependent on the student. But during your research project, if you come to UCL, you'll be able to use equipment like this to do 3 to 4 months of extensive research.
They're going to be doing stuff on these types of systems, using these types of automated systems.
They are indeed, if they choose to.
Oh, so there's a choice of research projects.
There is a delightful choice. You have a choice that is set out by our academic staff.
Mm-hmm.
Also, if a student has a particular interest, they can suggest a research project themselves.
That sounds great.
It is.
Should I be wearing gloves?
You should definitely be wearing gloves.
So you join us in a rare sight today as we have an MSc student just behind us.
You have to be quiet so as not to startle her.
So where are we? What is this place, Mike?
This is mammalian cell, the mammalian cell lab.
Why is this different from fermentation?
Ah, very good question. We like to keep them separate because mammalian cells, they're kind of a longer fermentation and therefore far easier to contaminate, generally by the things we would be growing in fermentation, microbes and such.
Okay. I mean, so we've done a lot of growing and a lot of purification work, but how far do we go the other end? I mean, do we do any cell engineering work? So within the field of synthetic biology, we have now the ability to control the genome to an extent where we can literally reprogram cells for whatever purpose we want. Usually we've chosen to use our skills for good. And so in my case, where we can try and reprogram a yeast cell to try and make a new vaccine of interest, others want to seek to re-engineer cells to try and create next generation biofuels or enzymes to try and facilitate chemical reactions that otherwise would be highly polluting if we were to use a totally inorganic method of synthesis. And I guess this really brings it into how a lot of the work the department does connects with industry as well.
Indeed, so we connect with industry in more than one way, either through collaborations for our research students or our researchers themselves, but also by getting them to come in so they can undertake some training from us.
So the modular training in bioprocess industries, or the MBI program, is a mechanism where industrialists can come in and not just deliver lectures to our students, but also learn as well. And the great thing for our students is that they get to understand how the work we're doing within the department is industrially relevant and actually used by those companies for their commercial purposes as well.
Indeed, and another benefit is, of course, you get to network with people from industry, which could be your future potential employers.
So basically, go to MBI courses, meet an industrialist, network, and get a job.
Yes.
That's good advice.